the Cooper School Administration for hosting, helping us host the conference here in 2010. Is there a number of students that are actually here? Anybody raise your hand if you're a Cooper student? Yay! Well, welcome again. All right. That means the rest of you are professionals and you're here to really grow me on the talk, so I'll keep that in mind. We're going to talk today about the BSD Certification Group and the professional certification that we're offering, or we're about to offer. It's in development right now. And we're going to talk about the lab exam a little bit. So today we want to cover who we are, what we're doing, why we're doing it, what the money and all that is involved, and we're going to talk about how we all went psycho in doing this. Actually, it's a little joke there. We're not actually psychos, but we'll talk about psychometrics and what that means for certification efforts. We'll have talk a little bit about the exam design for the BSD Professional, the BSD Lab design, and we're going to cover prototype, a demo. I've got a little demo here set up that we'll get running, and I'm gonna offer a chance for a volunteer to come down and do something here on the lab. So, just to pre-start your mind, if you have DNS experience and you can rapidly set up a small DNS for something on FreeBSD or one of the BSDs, I'll take a volunteer sometime during the talk for you to come up and do your thing, and then we'll take a little bit of time to go through that. We're also going to talk about future directions for the BSD Certification Group and what we're doing, and some things about how you can help. The BSD Certification Group started in 2005. We exist to provide psychometrically valid exams for BSD system administrators. We're taking the approach of system administration being the preferred certification, since our community is mostly geared around people who administer, operate, develop, and have a passion for servers in the computing industry. Not so much desktop. There is desktop BSD. It's quite powerful. I'm actually using one here in the talk, running PCBSD. But for the certification efforts that we're doing, we've been focusing mostly on servers. We incorporated in 2005 in New Jersey. Our formal IRS status is a business league. It's not a 501c3, it's a 501c6. That means that our contributions, unfortunately, are not tax deductible. And I got to tell you, we really tried with the IRS. We went back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. But they have more legalistic in their comings and doings and all that. So they have a prototype of a business league group for medical certifications that they've already determined is a business league. So we look almost exactly like that group. So anyway, we tried. We began the certification effort with the BSD Associate Exam. We started that development in 2005, finally released the first BSD Associate Exam in 2008 at Scale out in Los Angeles. And we had a successful launch there, and we've been continuing to offer that exam at conferences and in structured, proctored settings worldwide. We're going to talk about a little bit later on about some very interesting developments in that world as well. We also have other exams under consideration. We're looking at exams in the BSD firewall world. We're looking at virtualization. We're looking at embedded systems, and try to decide where we want to go next with certification. The why? Why are we doing this? Well, we're not doing this for money. We are not a vendor marketing organization. We're a community effort, and I think that's reflected in the way the exam has been developed and the way the exam is actually administered and set up. Our goal is to give our community, the BSD community, a solid footing to stand up and say, we can do what we do, and we can do it better than anyone else, any other operating system, any other group of administrators. We can do it as good or better than any of those people. And that's why we're doing it. We're not five guys in a garage coming up with questions. We actually have a program for how we develop certifications itself, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. We survive on public donations, purchases of our custom DVDs, which we have, I think we have one out on the table, but if we don't, you can always contact us and we'll ship you one. We do accept corporate sponsorships for some dedicated things that we're trying to accomplish, and also exist on individual goodwill. These are the numbers that we put together for our financial track. For the last few years, you can see that our expenses have actually exceeded our income, but fortunately, we have one particular expense that's important to us, and that's our psychometrician, Dr. Sandra Dolan, who's is working with us on psychometrics, and we've been able to pay her consistently to help us develop the exam, and that's been our big plus. So psychometrics, what are we talking about psychometrics? Psychometrics is a study and the science of measurement of knowledge. You can read about it. I'm not going to bore you with the details on it, but it's a requirement for a valid, psychometrics is a requirement for what you would call best-in-class certification or exam design, any type of exam design, really. But it's the best-in-class thing for doing that. It's the right choice for professional settings. So if you are a heart surgeon and you've been certified by the Board of Cardiologists, then you likely took a psychometric exam as a part of your cardiology training and stuff like that. You didn't take an exam by five heart doctors who were sitting in a garage coming up with questions. You took an exam that was professionally done and psychometrically done. And we're aiming at that level. That's the level that we're operating at. The future directions for what we're trying to do will require a psychometric exam design for all of our exams, and also some structured business design similar to ITIL or some of the other business processes that you might be familiar with. These are required for program accreditation by ANSI and ISO. There's an ANSI and an ISO standard, 17024, and that program will allow that program, the ANSI and ISO accreditation program, will allow any certification effort to be accepted by ISO and by IAC. That gives you instant credibility worldwide. And so we're structuring our certification program to be able to be audited and accepted by auditors from these organizations, ISO and ANSI. And that's going to give us visibility into governments, large enterprises who don't have the time or don't have the effort to investigate certification efforts, but they'll accept an ANSI or an ISO certified effort program. And so that's why we're doing the things in the way that we're doing it. The exam design itself, here's a list of the things that typically go into an exam design. You engage a psychometrician. Dr. Sandra Dolan is our psychometrician. She's worked with the Linux Professional Institute previously, and she's been very active in some of the other computer-oriented psychometric activities. She's a wonderful gal, and she lives in Illinois. She helped us come up with our framework for how we do all this, and some of these things are a direct result of having her help us guiding us through these processes as we develop the BSD Associate exam. But for the BSD professional, we've gone ahead and created a job task analysis. That's a survey that we took of the BSD community to help determine what activities are important and frequently performed by system administrators. And that survey we developed, I think it was earlier. It was late last year, and we published the results this year. So those results are on the website. You can read that. From that, from the effort of all of the people that participated in that survey, we came up with exam objectives that were based on the results of what people thought were important and what people thought were frequently done by system administrators. This is required under psychometric analysis. You have to actually determine that the task that you're testing somebody on is the same task that is frequently done or is very important to the performance of that task in the general industry. So we we've done that. We've published the exam objectives. Those are up on the website as well. The next step is to create exam questions. We need SMEs for all the BSDs. Anyone is welcome to help us develop these questions and so forth. We have an exam beta period where we'll have about 100 people, including anybody who would like to take the exam in beta format. And there's another step that's required in the psychometric world called an ANGOFF session. That's where all of the SMEs get together that are participated, or as many as can make it. And we go through each exam question, and we do some additional analysis on all those questions. And the outcome of that is the format of the exam, all the questions or all the activities that are going to be required. And then the psychometrician takes all that information and goes off and sets a passing score for how all that works. And then that determines, you know, whether or not, you know, if you're up above or below a certain grade or a certain number of points on the exam, you passed or failed. Then you launch the exam, and then you actually continue to evaluate the performance of the exam on an ongoing basis. So one of the things Dr. Dolan's been doing for us now is to be taking all of the BSD associate exams, running them through the psychometric analysis every time, and looking for things like, for example, are some questions always answered incorrectly? And if that's the case, then that particular question needs to be reevaluated. It's either got the wrong answer, or it's written in such a way as people don't understand the nature of the question adequately, and so they mark it wrong consistently. So those kind of analyses go into the psychometric portion of things. As a part of the lab as a part of the certification for the BSD professional, we've also considered having a lab exam, not just a papers exam, because we feel that the best, reaching again for the best type of certification effort, we want to be able to qualify people and certify people that we know have direct hands-on experience, can sit down and get the job done. So if you're an employer and you're looking to hire somebody and you're looking to evaluate whether or not that person has real-world experience, we want you to be able to look at our program and be able to say, well, if that person has passed the BSD professional exam, we know he's got hands-on experience, he can do the job. And that's why we're looking at having a hands-on lab. We've drawn ideas for the lab from several different similar exam programs. For example, the CCIE has both a written test and a lab exam, as you may be familiar with. And we're looking for ideas for the exam from everybody, from the community, once again. Now, not all ideas are workable because we're a small organization, we're a nonprofit organization, and we don't have the resources to do a full global spread like Cisco does, but we do have some good ideas, and we're looking to continue pushing them ahead. The general concept of the lab will have, this is the lab exam itself. The general concept is based on a lab booklet, such as an example that you see here. This is just a mock-up, it's not a real exam. But it has a set of real-world scenarios that you as a system administrator would typically, doing, or typically have these scenarios pop up in your day-to-day job. And generally they involve one or more tasks in the activity itself. So, for example, if you're going through and one of the scenarios says you need to set up a DNS server, or you need to set up a BSD server to operate as a web server, well, there might be several tasks to do that. You've got to install the operating system, you've got to install the software, you've got to configure it. I mean, the real world tasks that we're looking to get, looking to evaluate during the exam. Each task would have a point value, and you need to accrue points in order to pass the exam, just similar to any other exam. When we started looking at the lab and how to actually think about doing a lab, it was very confusing at first, and a lot of discussions were going on. We finally figured out that what we needed to do is come up with a set of requirements in advance for the lab to help us determine exactly how the lab should actually work. And so we came up with a number of requirements, and I just want to run down through these so that you get an idea of the nature of the exam and how we're positioning the exam and how we're looking at implementing it, so that you understand how all this works. The lab has to match the exam objectives. Obviously, you can't test somebody on stuff that they've never actually seen or never actually been presented with. So the exam objectives that we put together in the exam objective document are going to be where we base the exact activities. That's the basis for the activities that are going to be in the lab exam. The lab has to be proctored. Now, for you, all of you that have taken an exam before, where there's a person in the exam room making sure that nobody cheats and, you know, nobody's got materials that they brought in and so forth, that the proctor takes care of that. They ensure that no outside undue influence is being used in the exam to help you pass. So we consider, and also the psychometric world considers proctored exams to be best in class. So that's why we're doing that. The lab should be low cost, or actually must be low cost to us, to the BSDCG, but should also be low cost to candidates and to proctors. We don't think it's fair to price an exam in one market, for example, the United States, at $2,000 per an exam that is totally unreachable. That price point is totally unreachable to other members of the same community, the same BSD people, the same BSD developers in other countries, some of which do not have the resources to put down $2,000 for an exam. So we're not interested in putting together our program just to just for the U.S. market, but we're also looking to do it globally. And not everybody has the same amount of resources. So we're trying to position the exam so that it's low cost both to us and to the candidates and also to the proctors who have to either travel to these places or to be available to help out. The lab should be simple to set up, take down, and administer. In other words, minimal baggage. We don't want a lot of complicated hardware and things that you've got to go run through 15,000 hoops in order to set up and all of that. We want it to be as simple as possible. More requirements. The lab should focus on services and not on individual software products. We're not interested if you know how to configure Oracle SAP on a particular piece of hardware. We're interested whether or not you know the service of DNS or the service of the web, web services, or the service of other commonly known protocols. And those services are described very accurately in RFCs, in position papers by some of the authors, and so forth. So we want to see what you know about services, not whether or not you're an expert on Apache configuration, for example. The lab has to be reliable. If you're going to have people travel to a location and they're going to pay money, you have to make sure that the exam actually can be delivered right there, right then and there, and not say, well, we couldn't deliver it because we don't have a particular piece of hardware that that doesn't work that day, and so, sorry, can't do it. We want the test to be reliable, and no single point of failure should cause the lab to not be able to be delivered on site. The lab has to be secure, obviously, before, during, and after the exam. We don't want people to be able to bring in materials. We don't want people to leave materials on the lab workstations that somebody else could access later. We don't want people doing wireless from the lab and downloading stuff from the internet. We want to be able to have a secured environment where people can demonstrate their knowledge in with their own handiwork and put themselves into the exam. The lab has to be easy to score. We'd like it to be easy to score. You'd want to have the ability to score automatically a lot of particular things about a lab, because a lot of the things and services that you have, you can easily do automated scoring on, and we'll go through an example here maybe later on. It should be doable from anywhere. Internet access is not a requirement for the lab. In fact, we'd like to locate the exam, each exam environment, we'd like to isolate it from the internet. And that's because we don't want people uploading results that other people can download and make it easy on them to pass the exam. So internet access is not required. Lab must not be predictable. Again, you can't predict whether or not the same questions are going to be answered or the same scenarios are going to be given in the lab, so that if you took it today and you called up your buddy and said, oh yeah, I had DNS and I had this and I had that, the guy taking it tomorrow in a different city or a different state may not have the same actual questions or scenarios. So we don't want it to be predictable. And it's got to be as close to real-world scenarios as possible. Obviously, we're not testing you on whether or not you know some exotic piece of hardware or exotic piece of software that's not in use in the real world. We want real world. We want to validate real world experience. Well, we've had a lot of ideas that have come up over the years for the lab itself, and I just want to run down some of these so that you get an idea about what we've already thought about, what we've already covered. There's the online virtual lab where you have the bunch of workstations sitting around in some building or some site. Everybody's connected up to the internet. You have an exam server out there where you're taking an exam from, and you can say it's, you know, secured session. You can say it's this. You can say it's that. But if you have internet access, game over, really, in terms of validating experience from a single person, because it's always easy to figure out a way to pull information off the internet in some fashion. So we're not looking at doing it in that fashion. We looked at, you know, physically owned lab centers. We would go buy real estate in all these countries around the world and put up these you know, exam centers with our BSD logo out there, you know, and have people rush in to take the exam. Well, that's not going to happen either, because you could tell from our expense sheet earlier that we don't have those resources. Single server, multiple X session on an exam platform. There's some benefit to looking at doing that when a single server with multiple X sessions. We looked at the requirements for having 15 or 20 people hooked up and doing one of those, and that means you need to have a serious piece of hardware with some very serious memory and serious disk space and fast network and all that to do that. And it's a little bit pricey to do that, and it's not easy to take that that class of piece of hardware around to different places if you're doing a lab in different places. So we didn't look at that. The live CD with the virtual exam, it sounds good, but if you actually try to implement that, you find out that you're running from RAM in your own machine, and there's a very limited number of things you can actually do from a live CD. Yeah, you can do a telnet session or a SSH session off to your, you know, session someplace, but actually having everything on one machine is very, very difficult to do in a live CD environment. A candidate provided laptop with maybe a USB device that, you know, we would give them, they would plug in and boot from, so forth. We looked at doing that. There are some issues with BIOS incompatibility, that if the candidate brings in a certain laptop and you're giving them this USB drive to boot up from and do their lab on, and it might have worked good with your hardware and your lab that you were developing all this stuff on, but if you give it to some person who has a completely different piece of hardware, BIOS incompatibilities are going to eventually, they're going to eventually bite you. And we determined that was not an easy method to do. Right now, our preferred look at doing this is to have BSD provided laptops and hardware that we provide that would go into an exam session. The candidates would have their own dedicated laptop to have the exam delivered on, and they would take the exam from that. The advantage here is that we control hardware. We control the entire physical environment around the lab, and that means that people can't leave stuff on there or have session, you know, separate secret session where they have the ability to communicate back and forth and so forth. So we're looking at doing it with our own dedicated hardware and our own dedicated laptop. Now, you might notice, if you've been paying attention here, that goes almost directly against the grain into the fourth requirement. Goes against directly against the grain into the fourth requirement. It's got to be simple to set up and take down and administer. Minimal baggage. Well, if that means you've got 10 laptops and a little bit of hardware for networking, that's a little bit of baggage, but we're thinking that that's going to have to be something that we'll have to deal with. And maybe if we have the ability to engage with some testing centers and have dedicated hardware available to us, we might be able to do that. So here's the physical lab design, something that we've come up with so far, and we're looking at how this is actually going to work. The physical design consists of 10 or so desktops or laptops connected via 24-port switch to two exam servers, one Windows server and one BSD server. The Windows server is there for activities that involve interacting with Windows machines, which is a requirement in the real world. You have to get data and from Windows machines, and you have to store data on Windows machines, whether we like it or not. That's a real world activity. And so that will be a part of the exam. And then also an exam file server to provide certain test materials and scenarios and test data for use in the exam. Each workstation, and I think you can see them here, each of these workstations houses, each of these workstations houses five guest virtual machines. We're looking to do this with virtual machines, and we have a demo here set up that you can engage with, and we'll take a look at that. Each guest virtual machine can utilize tap and bridge devices within a BSD host to facilitate communication both between systems and between the BSD systems down here, the virtual machines, and the exam file servers through the switches. Now this particular design is a simple one. This has five BSD systems connected on one bridge, and they can all communicate back and forth between themselves, and they can communicate also to the file server. The file servers themselves, they use VLAN interfaces and VLAN aliases to incorporate the same networking. So in an implementation of this, one BSD host, that is, I guess I don't have a mouse here, sorry. Oh, here it is. One BSD host, including all five of these virtual machines here, can interact with the exam file server on one VLAN. And we can try to keep the VLANs separate by locking them down through a typical switch environment, Cisco switch environment. It's interesting to note that candidates in different scenarios would be required to set up their virtual machines according to a slightly different networking environment. So, for example, the previous solution had one bridge with five systems on it, which is basically a flat network. Another scenario might require you to create or to implement a tiered scenario. This is a typical two-tier DMZ environment where you have an external device, you have, which is say, for example, the exam file server. You have bridged to a firewall, which in the case on the left we have identified as the with the O as maybe an OpenBSD firewall. You've got an internal systems here, and then you've got a DMZ system out over here performing some operation. So you, as the lab candidate, would be required to set up this environment and also implement the whatever services that were called for in the lab on each of these servers. The one on the right, if you're a FreeBSD guy and you want to set up a FreeBSD file server as the firewall, well then that's your call. You know, you're a BSD administrator and you can administer BSD devices. We may require that you set up an OpenBSD server or a FreeBSD server, but if it's not required in the scenario, then it's up to you to implement the service on the software that you feel most comfortable with. Four virtual machines give you some flexibility in different kinds of networking administrative possibilities that you have. I sat down for about 20 minutes, and these are all I could come up with four machines. There's anything else that you try to put together is usually a variation of one of these. So you've got the flat network, which we looked at before. You've got the DMZ network over here that we looked at. You've got what looks like a load balancer type of scenario here that you might be required. This here looks like some sort of a failover scenario where you've got an external and an internal and two firewalls put together. This is some sort of tunnel type of environment over here where you're passing data all the way through systems, all the way end to end. And I don't know what this is over here. This is pretty, pretty strange looking animal. But four virtual machines offers a number of possibilities for administration. That's where this, that's the meaning of this slide. So a particular exam, you might be implementing a DMZ environment with this type of environment. You might be implementing a failover environment like this. You might be just in a simple bridge like this. So we have the ability in virtualizing the environment to create these different scenarios like that. As part of the exam, environment, we want to have all of the packages available for all of the BSDs that we're offering in the lab environment. So we want to be able to capture packages and packet source repositories on the exam file server. So, for example, if you want to load THTTPD as a web server, there would be a package for that. You'd load that and use that. Ports in this environment is not going to work because ports usually require compilation, usually require download of external software from some repository somewhere on the internet, and it's not as easy to provide a ports environment in this scenario. But we think we can do it with packages. It's going to require some disk space, but we think we can get it set up to do that. There's no exam content on the file server, so it would work out to do that. Well, what we did in setting up a workstation to get all this done is we did an installation on a FreeBSD host right down here with a customized install.cfg file, which loads a FreeBSD and multiple packages that are needed to run the actual lab environment. And I've got one here we're going to look at in a few minutes. After that initial install, which is just basic FreeBSD on the host, a secondary script downloads the overlaid files that are required for the exam. And the overlay files, you can see them up here, give the installer, who's actually installing this stuff on a workstation, gives them the ability to set up the workstation environment just like it'll be in the lab exam in a rapid period of time. On a GigE network, installation takes about 20 minutes, and you can overlap them, you know, by starting installation on one, letting it run for a little bit, starting another installation, and so forth. So you can do 10 systems in an hour and a half, something like that. But there's no exam content on here either, so. The interface, we've looked at several different virtualized environments. We looked at VirtualBox, we looked at VMware, we looked at QEMU, and we looked at AQEMU. And out of all of those, I got to tell you, QEMU performed the best in terms of its ability to handle virtualized environments, works with all four BSDs that are part of the lab environment, and has a very active community who's easily able to help us with any gotchas or quirks that are a part of the lab environment. We've been able to get it running, and we have two X window managers loaded. We're looking at running with FEWM, which is an older style, no frills window manager. We're also thinking of offering XFCE, but I don't have that one loaded on this exam demo here. There is a limitation with this software, and that's that you can't cut and paste from the host to a virtual machine, but you can cut and paste within the same virtual machine. So that's a limitation. We don't think it's too bad because we want a lot of people to actually be doing the configuration on these services and so forth directly. We've been able to get acceptable performance on commodity hardware with four or even five virtual machines running at the same time. You see a picture of it here, but I'll show you a demo here. And over here on the side, you can see this is Xload running in the background, and you can see that once the initial installs happened, the actual load on the host system went down considerably. And I've had, for example, all four BSDs doing their own kernel compiles, and it's a little slow, but it's workable, and you can actually get all four machines working quite handily and quite heavily without a significant degradation in performance. specialized hardware. You know, if we come up with a faster, niftier machine, more memory or whatever, it might improve performance even more. But it's runnable on a commercial, Acer laptop. I got this one at a national retailer for $300. So this is well within our capabilities. So here's a thought. Is there a victim? Is there a victim or a volunteer who'd like to come down and help us do a little bit on the lab for a DNS service? It's very simple. It's not doesn't require anything special or handy or anything else. But if not, then I will offer to do a demo at some point. But if you think you can come up here and work for a couple of minutes on setting up DNS, come on up. We'll give you a lab prototype here. This is a little bit of a real-world scenario about what we're looking to do. So here's an example. You've just been hired as the system administrator for Example Corporation, and there's been a major systems disaster, and your boss, Mr. Big, wants you to immediately set up a new BSD system and get the company back and running. He wants you to do it right now or else. So he gives you a list of things he wants back up and running in short order. For example, he wants you to install a new BSD development server according to a set of specifications that he'll give you for disk layout and user accounts, because that was one of the ones that crashed. He also needs you to set up a second BSD server to recreate some of the services that were lost, for example, DNS, web, FTP, again, according to instructions that he's got in his little notebook there, and maybe three or four other things that are a part of that scenario. So the lab example here, we've got DNS to set up on system B in one of these, and setting up these three or four DNS entries to test with. And then other things that might be done in DNS would be some of these other requirements, for example. Now, it's quite likely that the lab itself would be just this basic. You're given a list of things to do, and you have a machine to do it. It's just like the real world. Go get these things done. And I need it done by 5 o'clock. And that's very, very real worldish in terms of how you're looking to do stuff. Well, here's the scoring concept for all of that. The scoring concept is that we would look at having some scripts on the exam file server, and I confess that I do have the file server in my bag here, and when I booted it up just about an hour ago before the session, the video had crapped out on it, so it's something I need to deal with. But we do have some scripts that would run on that file server to log into the virtual machine that you were asked to provide the service on, run a test script, and those script requirements would be uploaded back to the file server, where a scoring script would then take a look at whether or not that particular service that you were asked to do was accurately performed. Basic idea is to score the test immediately. You can give the candidate a provisional result. For example, yeah, it looks like you passed. But we also want to do a more detailed analysis of everybody's lab results. So for example, we want to do the same kind of psychometric analysis of each of the lab activities so that you get a score based on your knowledge of all of the exam objectives. User and users, files and file systems, advanced services, general networking, user administration, that kind of thing. Those are all part of the exam objectives. Anyway, that's the slide for the victim who never showed up. But I want to run through some directions for the BSD Certification Group. We've talked some about the BSD Professional Lab, but I want to give you an idea about where we want to go on a couple of items. The proctor networks, we're looking at engaging with the proctor network in order to advance our ability to deliver the exam worldwide. We've talked a little bit about new certifications, and we talked about accreditation, but I want to cover a couple more things on that. So what is a proctor network? A proctor network is a company whose primary business is to provide proctored exams in environments in multiple locations, even multiple countries. We can engage with a company who already has the ability to have a proctor go to a location in Fayetteville, Arkansas, set up 10 systems, or you know, watch you sit down and write your exam for a written exam, and send those results back to us, and good to go. This is how the larger exam companies, this is how they scale. Even Cisco doesn't have their own specific network. They have engaged with for people to do this. We're looking closely at a company called Schroeder Measurement Technologies, SMT. The operational expense on this is about $2,000 per year. It's not that much money, but it would require some additional cost in our already low exam price. So this is a map of the proctor network for Schroeder Measurement Technologies, SMT, and it's as you can see, it's heavily U.S. centric, and there are a number of locations in the U.S. There's I would say there's probably on the order of about 200 or 250 locations in the U.S., and then a scattering of locations in Europe and other places. Even if we engaged SMT to do part of the proctor network, we would still offer the exams at conferences and local proctors, just as we do now. So this would be an additional effort to be able to deliver the exam worldwide. That would give us additional capability to get to people to be able to take the exam. Right now, the way we deliver it is at conferences just like this. So we'll set up a room, and we actually have engaged with a room here at this conference to take the exam today. I think it's around noon, and also tomorrow around noon. So I know some of you have already signed up for the exam, and you're going to be taking it. With a proctor network, you could call up, schedule your exam any time of the day or night or any day of the week, and you just go and take the exam. It's just like you would do with View or Pearson or Prometric or any of those other people. It's not as expensive as those companies, but it's the same kind of delivered service. We talked a little bit about the new certification ideas that we have already, the BSD firewall certification, embedded development, and so forth, virtualization, global enterprise. We haven't really decided on the next thing to do, but we're going to be taking a close look at it as soon as we get the BSD Professional launched and out the door. I put the slide in probably in the wrong place, but these are the benefits of ANSI 1704 accreditation that we talked about earlier. You get automatic recognition of your certification group by ANSI and international organizations, by governments, and unless you have that accreditation, you're not recognized. So right now, we, even though we have a valid, psychometrically valid program, can't go to the Department of Defense or the U.S. DHS or wherever and offer the exam, because they don't recognize you as an exam entity unless you are accredited by ANSI. So that's why we're looking at doing that. Wide industry acceptance, ability to offer much more comprehensive exam. It takes about 12 to 16 months to go through that process. We attended a seminar earlier this year on how to actually go through an accreditation by ANSI, and it takes it takes a little bit of money as well. The upside on this is that, again, your program is instantly recognized by governments all over the world. So if we are intending to scale BSD and you want it to scale in a reliable, professional manner, this is one way we can do that. Some additional notes about what it takes in order to get to ANSI accreditation. It takes a lot of documentation. They do an audit of your finances. They come in and they audit your program and so forth, and then you have to go fix any nonconformities. Fortunately, I'm actually an auditor in my day job. This is what I do. So as we looked at doing this program, I can already see exactly where we need to go in each one of these areas and what we have, the kind of documentation that we need to provide them. So it's not as nebulous, at least to us in the organization, it's not as nebulous as it might appear. So getting involved, hey, we need your help. We need people to help with the question pool. We need test scenarios to, you know, to be developed. We need some test scripts. We need lab improvements. We need donations and so forth. We need some beta testers that are going to be beta testing the exam and so forth. So if you're interested and you want to get involved, please stop by. Well, I'll have the exam out there a little bit later on, and we'll take a look at it. We have a BOF scheduled. Unfortunately, I don't know. I didn't actually get the BOF details when I was writing the slide. So I think it's in your program, but if it's not in your program, find us and we'll find me, and I'll direct you to the BOF. We will have some workstations available for your review and comment that are running that stuff. So please come by, sit down, do a little test drive. Tell us what you think about the virtualized environment, whether or not you find it workable, not workable, how you think it's going to work. We'll have a couple of workstations set up out there someplace, and give us some feedback. Anybody have comments or questions?
Between the virtualized environments and the host environment, are they able to communicate with each other?
The host and the virtualized environments cannot cut and paste, but they do have networking between the two, yes, over the bridge.
The solution for the cut and paste is to SSH into each one of those.
Sure.
From the host, and then that's
true. That's true. You can SSH into the host and paste a session, for example, or something of that nature. So, yeah, you can communicate. I think I hear the footsteps of doom behind me. So, another question, really quick. Go ahead.
This has been a production of BSD TV.